Hi everyone, I'm Junseok from High Performance Robotics Lab at UC Berkeley. Today we present autonomous flight through a cluttered outdoor environment using a memoryless planner. Our memoryless planner uses plans directly in sensor output, which is depth images from a depth camera in our case. The benefit of using directly planning in sensor output is speed, because it's computationally cheaper, because it doesn't require building a map or data structure such as OctoMap and KD tree. This planner is a local planner, planning only in a short term. Taking MPC-like approach, it plans in every depth image frame and execute a bit of trajectories. To overcome the issues due to the local planning, usually there is a global planner that can provide high-level goals, but not local trajectories. Local trajectories will generate from the local planner. Overall, we obtain state estimate, for example, position, attitude, etc., and the local planner uses that estimate along with the depth image, and it provides the actuator commands to the robot so that it can avoid obstacles. Simultaneously, a mapping module builds a map for global planning. Our planner is based on random sampling of trajectories and imposing constraints on those trajectories. This is possible as a real-time implementation on NVIDIA Jetson Xavier with a single core. The planning was done in every 33 milliseconds, so we could replan every new depth image. We use a polynomial trajectory as a primitive, which has a duration t, which is described in this equation. Alpha, beta, gamma are the coefficients to be determined from the terminal condition, and s zeros are the current state estimate. We also impose a zero terminal constraint on trajectories to enforce the recursive safety. We sample primitive first and then sequentially impose constraint. First, we check if it has a higher utility, is input feasible, is velocity feasible, and is collision free. If it passes all those constraints, then we now have a candidate collision free trajectory. I will explain those filters in the following slide. In sampling trajectories, we need acceleration. Instead of using acceleration directly from IMU, which is noisy and results in inconsistent trajectories, we use the estimated acceleration. Specifically speaking, we use this equation. C is the allow thrust command, and M is the mass of the vehicle, and ZB is the body axis, Z, and G is the gravity. This results in consistent trajectories across depth frames. We also use this utility function defined as this. Basically, this utility function is smoothly handle both situations when it's far from the goal and near the goal. When it's far from the goal, this term is negligible. And now this utility function became average velocity. So in this case, the planner tried to maximize the average velocity toward the goal. When it's near the goal, now DP, the term here, plays a role, and it makes the planner to choose a trajectory that ends around the goal. As seen in this figure, each trajectories are local. When it's far from the goal, it's basically maximize the average velocity toward the goal, denoted by G. And when it's around the goal, it tries to generate the trajectory that ends around the goal. In this slide, I will explain the collision checking algorithm. This is based on our previous research, so-called RAPPIDS, rectangular pyramid partitioning using integrated depth sensors. It first decomposes free space into a collection of collision-free pyramids. This allows the fast collision checking between a polynomial trajectory with the planar surface of each pyramid. formal details, please check our previous research paper. We also impose velocity feasibility constraint to limit the velocity. And basically this is to prevent visual inertial odometry from losing tracking at high speed. We check velocity extrema per axis. Specifically speaking, we take the derivative of our primitive polynomial trajectory to obtain the velocity expression. And we take the derivative again to find the extrema of the velocity. It should be noted that we check the velocity per axis. Otherwise, for example, if it was the checking the magnitude of the velocity, it would require solving higher order polynomials, which can be done only by numerically. If it's done by per axis, it's still a third order polynomial, then we can use the closed form root solution. Yo is a free variable for planner. And in this case, we adopt a very naive yo control, P control, to face the camera toward the goal. Since it's a naive approach, you can stuck in front of the wall. In this case, high-level planner can be introduced and provide more intelligent yo so that it could escape this situation.
Our Pathfinder relies on accurate trajectory tracking, which means that the low-level controllers should be able to track the thrust command from the Pathfinder well. The thrust command pipeline is shown here. The planner generates the desired thrust value and sends it to PX4 as normalized thrust or throttle in the range from 0 to 1. And the PX4, through its mixer, commands the four ESCs. The four ESCs then control the rotation speed of the four motors and generate thrust. However, like the ESCs used on most multicopters, the ESCs we used on our multicopter open loop ESCs, which means that as the battery's voltage drop, the thrust generated by each motor will also change even when the ESC command is constant. We can see this effect from the figure here. As the voltage of the battery drops from near full, which is 15.8 volts, to near empty, which is 14.3 volts, the throttle required for the vehicle to hover increased from about 0.56 to 0.64. This change in the required throttle value for the vehicle to hover, which was about 12%, is very bad for the trajectory tracking of the vehicle, because the Pathfinder cannot get the thrust it wants. And in cluttered environment, this is very problematic because when the trajectory tracking is bad, the vehicle may hit obstacles and crash. To mitigate this problem, we propose an approach which involves open loop calibration of the thrust plus closed loop adaptation of the thrust using the IMU measurements. For open loop calibration of the thrust, we put a motor and a propeller on a test stand and change the throttle command from 0 to 1, and we measure the thrust force at different voltages. Given the data we got, we proposed this model, which maps the throttle command to the thrust force generated by each motor. Here, Fi is the thrust generated by the motor I, Ui is a throttle command, Kv is a parameter dependent on the battery's voltage Vbat, and C0, C1, and C2 are three parameters independent of the battery's voltage. In addition to the open loop thrust adaptation, we also proposed a closed loop adaptation of the thrust using the IMU measurements. The reason is to balance out effects other than voltage, such as mass mismatch and propeller wear of the vehicle. We assume that the accelerometer's Z direction measurements measure the mass normalized thrust force by assuming negligible aerodynamic effects. And because the accelerometer measurements are very noisy, we apply an aggressive low-pass filter to the ratio of the accelerometer z direction to the normalized thrust. And we apply this as a multiplicative correction to the thrust command sent to PX4. At hovering, this adaptation behaves like an integral term on the height control of the vehicle. In hovering, the vehicle's height error because of model mismatch will drop to near zero as we apply this adaptation for some time. To validate the effectiveness of our Pathfinder, we built this quadcopter and did some outdoor experiments in a forest environment. The vehicle weighs 2.4 kilograms and the propeller's diameter is 229 millimeters. The hub-to-hub distance between two diagonal motors is 382 millimeters. The vehicle is equipped with MRO PixRacer flight controller running the standard PX4 firmware for the low-level control of the vehicle. The vehicle is also equipped with four cameras, a T265 VIO camera for odometry. The camera is mounted 37 degrees with respect to the horizontal ground to track features on the ground and to also avoid view occlusion from other parts of the vehicle. Intel Ryosen's D435i depth camera is used for detecting obstacles. Two other cameras, one RGB camera and one infrared camera, are not used for this project. The state estimation is purely based on the T265 VIO camera, and the GPS is not used. All the computations for the Pathfinder run on the onboard computer, which is an Jetson AGX Xavier. This block diagram shows the implementation of the codes. The motion planner, position attitude controllers, and thrust adapter run on the Xavier. The motion planner takes in depth images from the depth camera at a frequency of 15 Hertz, and the state estimation from the T265 tracking camera at a frequency of 200 Hertz. The Xavier and the PixRacer is connected via an UART link, and the desired thrust and desired angular velocity commands are sent from the Xavier to the PixRacer via the UART link. On the PixRacer, the angular velocity controller and PixRacer and the mixer are run, and the PixRacer send motor speed commands to the electronic speed controllers at a frequency of 600 Hertz. The experiments are done at the Richmond field station shown in the figure on the left. In the experiment, the vehicle flew 30 meters across the blue gum forest here, also shown in the figure on the right, from the starting point to the target point on the other side of the forest. Here, let me show some video of the experiment. The flight is fully autonomous with me as a safety pilot, and on the bottom right is a video from the onboard camera. We can see that the vehicle is able to avoid obstacles in its way and reach the target point 30 meters away. This video is a post-processed visualization of the path of the vehicle. On the right, we show the video of the RGB image and the depth image on board. And on the left, we show the trajectory of the vehicle as a series of frames, and the velocity of the vehicle is shown as a green arrow. Here we show the position and velocity of the vehicle during the flights for the X, Y, and Z directions. Here, the X direction is the direction from the starting point to the end point of the vehicle. The Y direction is the horizontal direction perpendicular to the X direction, and the Z direction is pointing up. We can see that the vehicle flew for about 30 meters on the X direction. On the velocity graph, we can see that the maximum velocity of the vehicle is about 2.7 meters per second. The maximum speed for each axis was set to 3 meters per second because experimentally, we have found that if the flight speed exceeds this limit, the VIO of the tracking camera can sometimes be unreliable. Because of the computational efficiency of the algorithm, the planner can sample a large number of trajectories during the flight, as shown in the first row. This allows us to sample each depth image densely. The sampled trajectories are then checked for input feasibility, speed limit, and collision. And the number of trajectories better than the current trajectory is shown in the bottom row. Note that at some time, the number of generated trajectories are very low, such as at 0.5 and 6.5 seconds. At about 0.5 seconds, the vehicle just started flying and it was pitching downward. So the depth camera was looking at the ground and cannot find much trajectories. And at 6.5 seconds, the vehicle was flying close to some obstacles in front of it. And it is also hard to find trajectories. In the experiments, we found some shortcomings of the system and we are going to address them in future works. The first thing is that the VIO tends to become unreliable when the speed is more than 3 meters per second. And this is a bottleneck for the flight speed of the vehicle. Another thing is that because RAPPIDS is a local planner, when the obstacles are very dense, it can get stuck. In the future, we are going to propose a strategy or a local planner to prevent it from getting stuck. Finally, we would like to acknowledge our sponsor, the Army Research Lab, for their support of this project. And we also want to thank our colleagues for their contribution to the testbed at our lab. Thanks.